Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to PHRN seminar series. This is absolutely wonderful to see so many faces, and I'm sure that many of you are here for Dr. Boerlin's presentation, or maybe for the pizza, but unfortunately we ran out of pizza because of this wonderful turnout today. To hear more about antimicrobial resistance, and where we are going to be going with antimicrobial resistance. But maybe now I should also give you a brief heads up here. There's quite a bit of movement within the university community around the topic of antimicrobial resistance and antimicrobial stewardship. And in fact, John Sargent and myself are going to be co-leading an initiative, the so-called NCE initiative, in this area in the future, and we are going to be having a conversation with poultry stakeholders, poultry industry, poultry researchers, and also government organizations that are involved in the process of antimicrobial resistance and antimicrobial stewardship in the next couple of months or so. Most likely it's going to be on April 24th. Many of you might have received the heads up, the save the date note that Ravi sent a few days ago. If you haven't, then please pencil in April 24 for our discussion panel around antimicrobial stewardship, specifically focusing on poultry. So that was my housekeeping item, but I also have a much bigger responsibility, which is to introduce my colleague and good friend, Dr. Patrick Boerlin. Dr. Boerlin is a native of Switzerland, but he's been off and on in Canada for almost, I would say, give or take 20 years. Give or take. He has a DVM from Switzerland, followed by a Doctor of Veterinary Medicine. And what H-A-B-I-L stand for?
It's a habilitation.
Habilitation from here in Switzerland. He came to Guelph to pursue a master's degree, I believe, with Dr. Carlton Giles. And at the time I met him, this would have been in the 1990s, probably 97, 98. He then went back to Switzerland, took responsibilities within the Veterinary Bacteriology Institute of University of PHRN, and then he came back to Guelph in 2002 to pursue his independent career as a professor in bacteriology. You would be amazed to know that Dr. Boerlin is such a decorated person. He has been in various different administrative positions. Just hang on for 1 second. He's been the head of bacteriology diagnostic laboratory at University of Bern, head of molecular epidemiology unit there, head of National Reference Center for Enteric Pathogens in Switzerland, and head of National Reference Center for Anthrax and Other Special Pathogens, and also he was on the board of directors for the Veterinary Bacteriology Institute. And you would be, like I said, amazed to know that Dr. Boerlin, at the tender age of 25, has actually been able to accomplish so much. So, his main area of research is molecular epidemiology of pathogens of animals and agents of zoonosis, including, among others, E. coli, Salmonella, Listeria, Borrelia, Leptospira, and the list goes on and on. And he is one of the, I would say, most wonderful individuals to work with, and also one of the most influential people in Canada in the area of antimicrobial resistance. So I'm just, you know, bumping up all the expectations.
Yeah,
so
yeah. I'm scared. I'm really scared now.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Now I have a reason to have gray hairs. Okay, thanks everybody for coming here today, and thanks for the invitation to present in front of this audience today. So I'm going to talk, to drive you through antimicrobial resistance. There will be quite a bit about poultry, but there will be also some general things that I'm going to talk about to take as example, which may apply to poultry. So the first thing I'd like to talk about is give you an outline. I'm going to talk about direct selection, okay? Give you a few examples, poultry and not poultry. I'd like to interact with you, so there will be a few questions for you. I will talk about co-selection, which is the mainstay of what I'm interested in at the moment. Okay, I don't like simplistic words. I like things complicated and deal with them, so co-selection is one of them. We'll discuss about, does it really happen or not? Is it important or not? And then I'm going to bring a little bit of something about the relationships between resistance and virulence. Okay, so let's start maybe with simple things, or things which are not simple at the time, but I think that citation from Darwin applies to what we are dealing with in antibiotic resistance. It's not the strongest of the species that survives, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change, okay? And if you, that's old, but that's still valid, I figure. If you look at generation times for humans, okay, 22 to 32 years approximately, it may have been a bit shorter in the early days, but that's what it is these days. Look at chicken, as far as I understand, a layer start laying eggs officially around 5 to 6 months these days. Again, it may have been longer before. Now look at our bacteria, generation time, 20 minutes. What does it mean in terms of that sentence? Look at the number of generations since the introduction of antibiotics. Three generations of humans, okay? Maybe 150 generations of chicken, approximately, since the introduction of antibiotics. And E. coli, 2 millions of generations at least, if not more. So that gives you an idea about the speed of adaptation, okay, and the responsiveness of different species to the problem of resistance. Bacteria, on top of it, they don't just multiply, E. coli being among the extremes with these 20 minutes, but Clostridium perfringens has a generation time of 10 minutes, it's even worse, okay? They don't just multiply and divide. They also exchange genetic material, so they don't have to wait for the next generation to change. They can exchange plasmids, among others, okay? These are the main important elements in terms of transfer of resistance. So plasmids can be transferred from one bacterium to the next without any cell division, okay? And lots of the resistance factor or resistance genes we deal with in human as well as vet medicine are encoded by genes on plasmids. Okay. So now I'd like to ask you a question to start with. It's about selection, okay? Now if I list these antibiotics here, bacitracin, where is bacitracin used in vet medicine? Can anybody answer me? Where is the major, in which animal species is the major use of bacitracin? Poultry, of course, exactly, okay? To fight necrotic enteritis. Then if we look at macrolides, mainly macrolides and maybe lincosamides, I would think maybe of tylosine. What is the major use of tylosine in animals?
Pigs.
Pigs mainly, exactly. Fluorphenicol, what is the major use? There may be other ones, but the major ones, okay? What would be the major use of fluorphenicol? In which species would fluorphenicol be mainly used? Pardon? Okay, fish, yeah, okay. Unfortunately, I don't have any example for fish. Among farm animals, terrestrial animals, where would be the main use in your mind? Cattle, okay. Pigs sometimes, but cattle would be the big one as far as I know, okay. Now, if we look at resistance, that's a study we did a few years ago with Georgia Slavish in the Animal Health Lab, shows you the distribution of minimal inhibitory concentrations for bacitracin in chicken, turkey, cattle, and swine. You have your bacteria with low MICs. These are the good guys, the susceptible guys to bacitracin. And then you have those with elevated MICs. Which species do we find them in? Chicken and turkey. Does it fit what you expected? Simple, okay? Or it sounds simple at least, okay. Erythromycin, which is a representative for the macrolides. We don't test tylosin usually in the lab, we test for erythromycin. Where is the resistance? Where did we expect it? Swine, okay, same thing. Look at the elevated, most of the elevated MICs, they are found in swine. Fits what we expect, beautiful word, it's simple. Fluorphenicol, okay, we expected to find resistance probably in cattle, and look at what we find. Here they are, that's cattle. Elevated MICs in cattle. So everything falls in place, it's nice, it's perfect. Perfect world. Another example of a perfect world is that story that a lot of people who have worked on antibiotic resistance or on chicken in general have probably heard about. It's the story of ceftiofur resistance in Salmonella and E. coli in chicken in Quebec. The whole story, I'm not going to go through the whole story, but to prevent, among others, to prevent colibacillosis. Chicken people in Quebec were using injection of ceftiofur in ovo. And resistance to CFTO4 appeared. The Canadian Integrated Program for Antibiotics Resistance Surveillance picked it up, and they found that there was a lot of resistance to CFTO4 in Salmonella Heidelberg, in humans. Okay, that's the red line. At the time, they were using CFTO4 Inovo, okay. They also found that there was a lot of resistance in E. coli, in chicken, in retail chicken, and that was also quite a lot of resistance, or even more resistance, in Salmonella Heidelberg in retail chicken. So they made some kind of a connection, and the farmers were not silly. They realized, oh, we have a problem. So they decided spontaneously to withdraw or to ban CFTO4. They stopped using it in 2005. Perfect world went down, okay? So the effect was there. They stopped using antibiotics, active pressure goes down, the bugs become susceptible again. That's perfect. Then they started using a little bit of CFTO4, not constantly, and the resistance crept up a little bit in 2007. Okay, that's a perfect world, I think. So far, so good. Looks like we're in control. You will agree with me, probably, okay? Antibiotic drives resistance. We take off antibiotics, resistance goes down. Okay, that's perfect. Would be nice if it would remain like that. Unfortunately, we have to deal with multi-drug resistance and co-selection. So I'm going to illustrate it here with an example of a population of bacteria which contains susceptible bacteria, which are the green ones, and then bacteria which are resistant to antibiotic A, and some are resistant to antibiotic B, okay, but only to one antibiotic. That's what we call monoresistance. But you have the presence of both in that population. And we are going to compare it to a population where you have your susceptible bacteria, and you have bacteria which have both resistance at the same time in the same bacterium, okay? So now what we are going to do is we are going to put them under antibiotic A and look at what happens. We have only the resistant ones to antibiotic A surviving here. And of course, these ones are resistant to both, so they are going to grow and survive. Next step, I'm going to change antibiotics, okay? I'm going to use antibiotic B. Pretty straightforward. I'm going to kill all the guys on the left, and look at the guys on the right, okay? And that's what happens if you think about co-selection, because you now have a resistance to both antibiotic A and antibiotic B. You've selected resistance to antibiotic A by using antibiotic B in that case. And I would like to get you to think in terms of poultry, what it means in terms of rotation of antibiotics. And that's a practice, I think, which is going on, for instance, in Quebec, for the prevention of colibacillosis. They used to alternate CFTO4 and spectinomycin. CFTO4 is gone now, but for several years, since 2007, they were using alternatively CFTO4 and then spectinomycin, then going back to CFTO4, then going back to spectinomycin. So you can imagine probably what could have happened in that case. Okay. That's an illustration of where multidrug resistance and co-selection can play a role. Okay. Now I have, so you can imagine that the world is maybe not as simple as I showed you in the first slides. I'll start with the swine story now, and we'll go to chicken afterward again, or poultry afterward again. That's a story of a study we did in Switzerland when I was still there. Swiss authorities were pretty smart, I think smarter than the EU, the European Union at the time. When the swine report came out, they realized that we should not use antibiotics which are used in humans as growth promoters. Very smart move. The only not so smart thing they did is they made an exception for tylosine. And that was a mistake. Then in 97, they banned the use of avoparcin in animals because avoparcin was selecting enterococci, which were resistant to vancomycin. And vancomycin is very important in human medicine. And enterococci, vancomycin-resistant enterococci, are important in human hospitals. And there were some studies in Europe showing that, or suggesting that vancomycin resistance in human hospitals had been brought up, or at least increased by the use of avoparcin in animals. So they banned it, okay? And in 1999, finally, they decide to ban all antimicrobial growth promoters, not only those which were important for human medicine, but any antimicrobial, practically, okay, including tylosin at that time. So we jumped on that opportunity, and we looked in enterococci from swine what was happening. We did a study where we took samples in 13 farms, 1 or 2 weeks before the ban, in farms which were still using tylosin. And we followed up 7 weeks later and looked at what happened. And if you look at the resistances here, erythromycin, spiramycin, and clindamycin, you have the same gene responsible for these resistance, all of them, and that's erythromycin resistance in general. Okay. So if you compare, you have a nice drop of resistance already 7 weeks after the ban, which is beautiful. What happened at the same time in these same farms, and they were using only tylosin, they were not using other antibiotics, at least as far as we know. Look at that. You have a decrease in other resistances at the same time. So if you stop using one antibiotic, you may have collateral effects in one direction or another. Okay. We'll go further. It's enterococci in general, it's a whole bunch. It's a zoo, practically. So we looked a bit further at the actual target, which was Enterococcus faecium. Same study, same farms, and so on. And we had the same effect of decrease of resistance in Enterococcus faecium, not only for macrolides, but also for other antibiotics. That's a nice effect. Okay. The problem is, in 1999, when we started the study, okay, avoparcin had been banned since 2 years. But VREs were still present in our swine. And what we noticed is that these VREs, these vancomycin-resistant enterococci, were containing or were having genes for macrolides and vancomycin resistance, both on the same plasmids. Approximately at the same time, there was a group in Denmark who was doing a bit the same kind of things. They were smarter than the Swiss. They banned avoparcin in 95 already, okay? And in 98, they noticed that vancomycin resistance in enterococci from chicken had dropped. Beautiful, simple world again, and fits what we expect. You stop using an antibiotic, resistance goes down. But when they looked at swine, VRE frequency had stayed stable. Can you imagine why? Or one of the major explanations they came up with is that story here. They had a vancomycin resistance gene and a macrolide resistance genes, both on the same plasmid in these VREs. And in swine, they were still using tylosin. So they kept the selective pressure to keep vancomycin resistance through the use of tylosin in pigs, but tylosin was not used in chicken. Got down. Okay? I think it makes sense. But it tells you about the complexity of the stories and what co-selection can play potentially as a role. Okay, so good, so far so good, maybe. We are seeing some side effects and sometimes unexpected persistence of antibiotics we didn't think of, okay. So I'm going to show you now some stuff from here. And it's about plasmid work that we did at the Public Health Agency a few years ago. So the way we do our plasmid work, we usually take a bacterium which contains frequently, and it's E. coli and Salmonella, they frequently contain lots of different plasmids, okay? What we do in the lab, we extract these plasmids, respectively Gavin is doing that all the time, put them in test tube, and then through an electric shock, we do what we call an electroporation, and throw these plasmids into an E. coli, a lab E. coli. Most of the time, you have only a single plasmid going on. It can be this one, or it can be this one, or this one. Take the example of one which has a resistance gene. Now we select those bacteria that we call transformants on the plate with their corresponding antibiotics, and only these guys are going to grow, not those with the other plasmids. We've isolated a plasmid in a bacterium. And now we can look at the bacterium, what characteristics have changed compared to the original one which didn't have the plasmid. Okay. So we can do a lot of experiments, we can look at susceptibility testing, we can do some PCR to characterize the plasmids, and lots of other characteristics we can look at, okay? So that's an example, a broad example, related to ceftiofur. And that's
Canada-wide. We've looked at plasmid for ceftriaxone resistance, and we've looked at E. coli and Salmonella. Okay, so we took only isolates which were resistant for these for ceftriaxone and which were carrying the gene BRCA1/2, which is the main ceftriaxone resistance genes in these bacteria. We looked at isolates from cattle, from swine, and poultry, and that's why I'm showing it here. Okay, and what I'd like to have you noticing is Salmonella E. coli, frequently they share the same plasmids or plasmids which are indistinguishable. Okay, you have three examples here. If you look at other characteristics of the plasmids, we can classify them in subgroups which are called incompatibility group. And we noticed that there were five different incompatibility groups among the plasmids carrying the CMY2 gene in bacteria, in E. coli and Salmonella in Canada, from in animals. Okay, so the next step was doing susceptibility testing of our transformants to see which resistances were associated with the plasmid carrying the CMY. And again, I'd like you to notice that group here. It's called INC-AC group. You have the resistance here to beta-lactams. They are all encoded by that CMY2 gene, so nothing marvelous about it. But look at the other resistances within that group. You have chloramphenicol resistance. Okay, chloramphenicol is not used anymore since quite a while, but it was also linked to fluorphenicol resistance. Okay, we had some resistance to gentamicin and kanamycin, not too much, but it was present once in a while. But tons of resistance to sulfonamides, tetracycline, and sometimes sulfonamide trimethoprim. So tons of, it's a multi-drug resistance plasmids, if you want, okay? The other ones were absolutely not like that. They had only that CMY gene and nothing else. Okay, look at chicken. The vast majority, I don't give you the number of plasmids in each category, but the vast majority of the plasmid we had from Salmonella and E. coli from chicken were from these groups, which encode monoresistance, if you want, only beta-lactams. And that fits nicely to what we've seen in Quebec when they stopped using ceftriaxone and used other antibiotic, ceftriaxone resistance went down because the plasmids encoding the resistance were encoding resistance only for ceftriaxone. They could not be co-selected by other antibiotics, okay? If you look, so I think poultry was very lucky there. If you look at the cattle people, they were much less lucky. The poor guys had to deal only with plasmids from the INC-AC group, okay? And you remember we said fluorphenicol is used in cattle, okay? For bovine respiratory diseases, among others, okay? Look at the resistance here in that group. So they were probably co-selecting it. They were also using ceftriaxone, probably. Okay? So these guys are much less lucky than poultry people are. Okay. So far, so good, I think. Question is, we were lucky, will we be always lucky like that? Maybe not, maybe. So, to get a bit more to more serious things, 2 or 3 years ago, I was contacted by Marie Nadeau from the MAPAC, that's the Quebec equivalent, I think, of OMAFRA. And she's leading the labs, the surveillance, the resistance surveillance lab for MAPAC in Quebec. And she had a problem. Her main problem was, you have two resistances here. The bold one is gentamicin. They had seen resistance increasing in avian pathogenic E. coli in Quebec over the past years, okay? And the problem with that is supposedly, at least, and I think it's more or less true, gentamicin was not available anymore for chicken farmers. So what was going on there that they had this continuous increase in gentamicin resistance without use of gentamicin? And at the same time, their worry was that ceftriaxone resistance was increasing in parallel to it. So was it related to the use, again, of ceftriaxone, or was something in common with the use, or with the resistance to gentamicin? After a few discussions, we understood that farmers had introduced that thing we talked about earlier, that alternative use, ceftriaxone, spectinomycin, ceftriaxone, spectinomycin. So they were using Inovo, a mixture of spectinomycin and lincomycin. Lincomycin doesn't work on E. coli and Salmonella, so we don't really care. But spectino does. Okay. So we came up with a number of questions to try to hypothesis to answer her question. Just to put a bit of a context before we go to our questions, that's the situation in Ontario, apparently in APEC in 2016. That's results that Dr. Varga and Guerin are generating at the moment in a project supported by OMAFRA. Gentamicin resistance, 2016, is quite similar to what they had in Quebec. Ceftiofur is lower, okay. The reason may be Ontario is not Quebec, but the reason may also be that we are not using ceftiofur in chicken and poultry at all anymore, okay. So probably there was a decrease here. That's for Ontario. So now why am I talking about that all the time? It's because some of these antibiotics are critically important. You have a classification from the WHO and a classification from the OIE about the importance of antibiotics. And if you look at gentamicin and ceftiofur, they are classified by both as critically important antibiotics. So these are really the top antibiotics for human medicine and vet medicine. Then you have the very important, and then you have the important ones, okay? And spectinomycin is only among the important ones. So it's a minor antibiotic, if you want, in terms of resistance. That's what it means, practically. It's not insignificant, but it's minor. Okay. I don't completely agree with these classifications, but that's another topic. Okay, questions that we had then, based on all this information, were, is there a relation between gentamicin resistance in APEC and spectinomycin use? Is there anything going on there? Or is there also a relation between gentamicin or spectinomycin resistance and ceftiofur resistance? You've seen this parallel increase. Okay. Maybe something is going on, a single thing is going on, and is it driving both? Okay. So what we did is we used our molecular approaches to tackle the issue. We first went to assess what are the genes encoding for these resistances, because we didn't have much information on some of them, at least. For instance, gentamicin, we had no clue which genes we would find in there. It had not been described precisely before. For ceftiofur, we were expecting that CMY2 gene I mentioned before. And for spectinomycin, there is practically only one gene which was known for it. It's the so-called AADA gene. But gentamicin, no clue. Okay. So we first looked at which genes we were dealing with. And then we looked at associations between the presence of these different genes in APEX. Okay? And then once we had our associations, we went into molecular work and tried to see if the different resistance genes were located on the same plasmids or not. Okay? Should be, I think, relatively logic after what I showed before. Good, that was our approach. To do that, we took a collection of APEC from Quebec that Marina Do gave us. They had originally more than 1,300 E. coli isolates from these 5 years here, okay? And we took a subsample, tried to arrange it equally over the 5 years. We tried to have a sufficient number of isolates which were resistant to gentamicin only, resistant to ceftiofur only, resistant to both, and a control group susceptible to both, okay? And we looked at the resistance genes in there. What you have to keep in mind is when we selected, we absolutely disregarded the spectinomycin susceptibility. We didn't look for it. It was completely random, okay, just to make clear. Good. So we looked for a number of genes. That was the CMY, as you can expect, for ceftiofur. There were two other genes. We were not sure if we would find them or not. They are so-called ESBL gene, extended spectrum beta-lactamases. They encode for ceftiofur and third-generation cephalosporin resistance. For gentamicin, we started with 5 Gavin, I think, and we ended up with 3 where we had positive results. And these are the 3 genes here. I'll get back to them in a minute. And then, as I said, AADA is the only one which was known for resistance to spectinomycin. So we screened for them with PCR. And that's the resistance genes for gentamicin. And as you can see, that gene, the AAC36, okay, was the major one that we found in all these APEC. It encodes practically only for gentamicin in terms of therapeutic antibiotics resistance. ADB was frequent once in a while, but not too often. It also encodes for kanamycin resistance on top of gentamicin. And we found very few of these, which is good news for the poultry industry. This AAC34, because it encodes resistance to tobramycin. And as far as I know, tobramycin is used in poultry, particularly in Turkey, if I'm not wrong. Okay, so that's good news for the industry, I think. Oops, sorry. Safety of food resistance, nothing really brilliant. CMY, as we were expecting, it's everywhere. Okay, but something new came up. We were more or less expecting it, but, and that's why we tested for it. It's the so-called BLAST CTXM gene. More precisely, it's a CTXM1 gene, and that's a gene which is new to Canada. 10 years ago, we didn't have it anywhere in Canada in animals. Okay, and it showed up in these APEC at low frequency. And the SHIV gene is a gene which may have been frequent earlier, but which doesn't show up that much anymore. Spectinomycin resistance, we'd know if there were other genes or not. So the only way we had to look for it, we looked at minimal inhibitory concentrations and look at the distribution of our gene among these concentrations. And I think it's pretty clear that when the gene is present, the MICs are always elevated, or for the vast majority. And it explained practically all the resistance to spectinomycin that we can see. Okay. So it's a simple situation here, only one single gene. So in terms of summarizing what we found, gentamicin, practically only one gene, that AAC36, as significant. Spectinomycin, practically only ADA, and it explains most things. Okay, that's good. And then in terms of safety of food resistance, CMY explained the vast majority of things. Okay, so we can focus on these in terms of doing stats. The CTXM1, as I mentioned, appeared, and it appeared in 2011, and that's exactly the same year as it appeared in the CPARS collection, the first isolate we screened from CPARS, which were showing CTXM, CTXM1 in particular, were from Turkey, and no other animal species. So it seems that that gene has emerged in poultry first in Canada. It's not, as far as I know, it was not present in humans in 2011. It started to appear in humans in 2012-13. But again, that's another topic. So just to compare, because it's all Quebec, you are probably all from Ontario here, and you'd like to hear about Ontario. So we have in our lab Pauline, who is doing some work on cephalosporin resistance. And she's looking at abattoir samples from CPARS from 2016 in Ontario. Okay, that's cecal samples, if I'm correct. And she looked at 242 samples, cecal samples, okay, from slaughterhouses in Ontario. And she did enrich for cephalosporin resistance, okay? And that has implications too. And she found that 38 of her sample, that means practically all of them, 98%, had a cephalosporin resistant enterobacteria assay in them, practically always E. coli, okay? So almost all of them have it, but that's through enrichment. That does not mean that every salmonella or every E. coli in a cecal sample is resistant. That means that every animal practically has some resistant E. coli or salmonella in its gut. Probably not the majority of the bacteria, okay? Just to make clear. But still, they are there, low level, but they are there. You treat with ceftiofur, they are going to pop up, okay? Just keep that in mind too. Now, these isolates, she didn't do the PCR yet, it's coming, but she looked at the phenotype, resistance phenotypes, and 90% of them are fitting to a CMY2 profile, okay? Approximately 7%, 7 to 8% fit to a CTXM profile, okay? And as I said, the vast majority of them are E. coli. We didn't find much other bacteria, enterobacteria assay, which would be resistant, okay? She also looked at clinical isolates, okay? And I've showed you data from beside the graph with this increase in Quebec. I showed you the situation in Ontario with the data from Dr. Guérin. Okay, she found approximately similar numbers. They had 17%, she has 14%. Selection criteria are not exactly the same, but overall it fits. Okay, so resistance in APEC in Ontario is not that high, but it's present. Good. So I go back to my Quebec thing and my associations now that you've got a hint of Ontario. So when we looked at the association between our ADA gene for spectinomycin resistance and the two major other ones, AC3 for gentamicin, we found a huge positive association. It was so strong that every single AAC3 positive isolate had an ADA. There was no exception to that. Okay? So the odds ratio is huge. For CMY, which is ceftiofur resistant, and that good news, the association was very strong, but it's a negative one. That means if you have the ADA gene for spectinomycin resistance, you are less likely to have a ceftiofur resistance than if you don't have the spectinomycin resistance. That's good news, I think. So there is no positive association and potential co-selection happening, probably. Okay. That's our conclusion from what we found here. That's statistics. As molecular biologists, we want to see things practically in the lab. Okay. So Gavin did some more electroporations. And he took something. He took 38 isolates, which were both ADA and AC36 positive, spectinogenta, okay, resistance. Transferred them in a recipient and selects with gentamicin resistance and looks if he transfers the ADA at the same time as he transferred the AC36. All of them, there was a co-transfer, and that fits to our stats, where every AC36 positive is also positive for ADA. And that it tells us, yes, it's not only that, but they are co-located on the same plasmid. Okay. He did some sequencing also, and he showed that these two genes are part of what we call an integron. These are resistance gene fishing machines, if you want. And associated with that is a sulfonamide resistance gene, which is always present there. So we don't have only these two, we also have sulfonamide resistance. On top of that, he looked at, you remember in that tree I showed you with the CMY plasmids, they were incompatibility groups, okay, big groups, subclasses of plasmids. He did the typing also for these incompatibility groups with his 38 transformants and showed that the plasmids carrying these two genes and the SUL1 belong to 5 or 6 different incompatibility groups. That tells you that this integron, which carries SUL1, ADA, AC36, is moving around very actively between plasmids. Does come completely as a surprise for us, because we know that integrons are usually part of transposons. Transposons move from one part of the genome to another, from one plasmid to another, and so on. So it all fits together, okay? But these guys are moving around like hell. He also looked, since we were interested in that association, spectinomycin and CMY, ceftiofur resistance, we had a negative association, so we were expecting to not have too much collocation on the same plasmid. So he took 29 isolates, which were resistant to both spectinomycin and ceftiofur. He threw them in a recipient strain and selected with ceftiofur to see if the ADA moved together. That means if it was on the same plasmid. Out of 29 that he looked at, 19 had both genes together. Okay. That doesn't fit completely our negative association, whereby when he took the one which were resistant to both, that's a minority anyway. Okay, so he still found that 2/3 of those which have both resistance have both gene on the same plasmid. So there is a potential for co-selection. When we look at the actual population, it doesn't seem to happen, but there is a potential for it. Okay. Since ceftiofur resistance is starting to be encoded not only by the CMY gene, but also by the CTXM1 gene, he also did some work on that, okay? Took two isolates which were carrying the CTXM1, the AC36, and the ADA, transformed and selected on ceftiofur for the CTXM1 gene. Only the CTXM1 gene went over. So there is practically no possible co-selection of the CTXM1 by the use of spectinomycin, which is excellent news, I think. Okay. So co-selection, yes or no? I think we have some data which, at least at the molecular level, support the idea that it's likely to be occurring actually for gentamicin through the use of spectinomycin. So beware, since we've stopped using ceftiofur and we are using spectinomycin, at least in Quebec now, we may go for a surprise at some point, okay? The co-selection of ceftiofur resistance is potentially, or is possible, but is probably not occurring yet, but it could come one day, okay? And for the CTXM1, the co-selection is very unlikely. So there is a mixture of good and bad news here, because I remind you, gentamicin is a critically important antibiotic for human medicine and vet medicine. Good. So I think we are only half lucky with that. So now I'm going to go to another further dimension of co-selection. Okay. I'm asking you, if you are at the place of a bacterium, you are a pathogen, you are an APEC or you're in Salmonella, and you're penetrating a chicken to the mouth. And that chicken has been treated with antibiotics. So you receive all these antibiotics in your face. You are a smart guy. You have plasmids with lots of resistance genes. You've put them all together on the plasmid, and you're multi-drug resistant. Now, once you went over that, you are going to face something else that Cheyenne is very familiar with. It's the immune response of the host, okay? That's another aggression. That's just an aggression, like the antibiotics are an aggression for you, okay? So what are you going to do if you face that? For me, I would be a bacterium. I think I would tend to put everything together, okay? My virulence factors, my resistance factors, and maybe some colonization factors to help me stay in the chicken, all together on the plasmid, and I have all the weapons I need, okay? So I have a concept for it. That's what I would call plasmids expendables, okay? I think that fits quite well. Good. Now I know you may not like that kind of movies. So if you don't like them, I would not recommend to read the scientific literature either, okay? Because if you read that paper, you'll be as scared as you would be with these guys, okay? It's a lot of text. I just want to stress a few points there. It's a group in the state who started that study when they saw Salmonella Kentucky frequency increasing in chicken in the states. And they did some characterization of plasmids, okay? And they found in their Salmonella Kentucky, several plasmids. One of them, this one, which was encoding for streptomycin resistance and tetracycline resistance. Not spectinomycin, okay? Streptomycin only. But still, two antibiotic resistances at the same time, okay? They had another, it's another one, another plasmid, which was carrying the CMY2 gene. It's one of these INK-I1 plasmids, which code only CMY and nothing else, okay? But these two were together in the same Salmonella Kentucky. When they characterized that plasmid a bit further through through sequencing, okay, they found that that plasmid, okay, was very similar to a plasmid from an APEC, the avian pathogenic E. coli, and that was in a Salmonella Kentucky. And when they went further, they found that that plasmid is carrying six groups of virulence genes, which are very important for APEC, among others for colonization. Okay, and that fits absolutely nicely the increase of Salmonella Kentucky in chicken with the acquisition of that plasmid, which provide the Salmonella additional virulence and colonization factor to colonize the gut from chicken. Okay. So that one for me would be scary, because you have a combination of colonization factor. Okay, the Salmonella Kentucky doesn't make the chicken sick, okay, but it's there in big numbers. Okay. So probably these guys here are helping for the colonization, but by doing that, at the same time, they maintain resistance genes in there. So we may have two things potentially happening, is through our use of antibiotics, we may sometimes select for more virulent bacteria, or the maintenance of virulent plasmid, but also the adaptation of a bacterium to the host may also select for the persistence of resistance. And to me, it's a very scary thought, okay? And that's something which goes in the direction of the expendable, I think. Okay, so don't read it if you don't want to be scared. Good. If you look at, it's in the States, okay? Well, in Canada, it's different, don't we? Okay, so I looked at the CPARS data, and we were a bit involved in the original stage of studying that. I think they've stopped, but if you look in 2003, in the abattoir samples, the cecal samples from chicken, okay, the main serovar Salmonella was Heidelberg, 50%. That was really overwhelming. And Salmonella Kentucky was only the second one with only 17%. It's not too much, okay? And resistance in the Salmonella Kentucky, only 5 or 6% were resistant at all to any antibiotic. Okay, they were good guys. Okay, they were not making the chicken sick. They are not too invasive for humans, and they were not too resistant. So that's not too scary, I would say. Okay, 2004, okay, if you look at that, Salmonella Kentucky is slowly increasing, Heidelberg is going down, okay, and they observed suddenly a new resistance profile they didn't see before. And look at that profile. It's exactly the same as the profile from the Salmonella Kentucky from the States. Safety of full resistance, that's what it means here, okay, streptomycin tetracycline. Beta-lactam resistance and streptomycin tetracycline. That's the same as they had in the States. So it seems to have started or showing up in their data, at least in 2004. Look further, 2008, frequency of Kentucky. It's the most common one. It took over Salmonella Heidelberg, okay, position, 40%. And it's the main serovar associated with streptomycin tetracycline resistance. Should give you an idea when you read, if you remember the paper I just cited. Probably we have that plasmid, that APEC plasmid with resistance on it, which is in our Salmonella Kentucky too. Okay. And if you look at the data from 2013, you have similar data. It's even worse probably in chicks when they are placed in the farm. So we are probably not that different from the States. And as I mentioned, fortunately, we are lucky once more, or the poultry industry is lucky once more, because Salmonella Kentucky is not invasive in humans. It's not a major serotype in humans in terms of causing disease, or severe disease at least. So we're lucky that we deal with one which is maybe bad in terms of colonization, in terms of resistance, but for human health and public health, it's not so scary yet. Okay. Good. So we were wondering about all these virulence things. And when we had, since we had our APEC from Quebec and we looked at the resistance and plasmids, we thought, oh, why don't we look at virulence at the same time? And we started, respectively, Gavin again, started a whole number of PCRs for virulence genes, which are not all, but most of them encoded by plasmids. Okay? So we had virulence genes which were for iron acquisition. It's very important for bacteria in terms of their virulence and survival in the host, a whole number of them. We had some virulence factors which were adhesins, and some, like the TSH, is a mixture of adhesin and protein activity. Okay. We had some real proteases, like the OMPT. We had some genes for serum resistance, resistance to the complement. We have a neck flux pump, which we don't know exactly its relation with virulence, but we know it's statistically associated with more virulence strains. Capsule formation, a well-known virulence factor, protects the bacteria from the immune response of the host. And then a colicin gene, which has been associated with virulent apex since a long time. We still don't know exactly what role it plays. Okay, so 13 genes that we looked at. Oops. Okay, so we looked at associations again between AADA and our virulence genes. And lucky again, okay, we found very few significant associations, and the few we found were negative associations. So the presence of spectinomycin resistance, it seems to be potentially associated with less virulent strains. Good news again, I think, okay. Good, again, we looked at plasmids. We have to look at our molecular data. And Gavin went to all these transformants he had. He had 53, which had the AADA gene. And he looked, OK, does it fit our negative association? I should not find too many virulence genes on these plasmids. Okay, and bingo, he found only 2 out of 53, which were carrying virulence genes. Okay, that's a pretty small proportion. And I think, again, we're lucky there. They belong to an incompatibility group we've seen before. Okay. These two plasmids were encoding, of course, AADA and the gentamicin resistance, which is a bit worrisome. And they were also encoding tetracycline resistance. No other resistance genes apparently on there. But the virulence genes, there were 7 of them on these two plasmids. The two plasmids were practically identical as far as I understand. Okay. There were 7 virulence genes on there, 3 of them for iron acquisition. You had the serum resistance gene, you had adhesin and protease, you have that famous colicin gene, okay, and that efflux pump, we don't know exactly which role it plays. 7 of them, 5 of these 7 are the same virulence genes as you find on the plasmid from the Salmonella Kentucky. So let's stress again the similarity between the APEC and the Salmonella Kentucky story, okay. Good. So time to conclude, I think, slowly. My question to you is, how long do we want to count on being lucky? Because not everybody has been lucky like the poultry industry, I think. Look, ask the beef people, ask the pork people what they think. I think the poultry industry has been lucky, but it's only luck. I think it's not necessary, from what I understand, being obtained on purpose, okay? So we have to be extremely careful, and there are a few issues that we should tackle. We know that we have to deal with direct selection. It's a reality, no way. You've seen, I think, good examples of it. But what we should do is to go beyond simplistic models, okay, and look more seriously at co-selection issues, what they mean exactly in terms of our antibiotic use, prudent use, and stewardship, as John would say, okay. We may have to deal with some serious issues at some point, like the selection of critically important antibiotic resistances by antibiotics which have no importance for humans or only very little importance for humans. Okay. And with the clustering of genes we see on single plasmids, there is also a potential for that play going further between virulence and resistance, or colonization and resistance, which to me is a very scary phenomenon, which may be difficult to control. Okay. But that's all molecular stuff that I've showed you, okay? So some may argue, I think it will be right to argue, okay, you have your bunch of resistance genes, let's say spectinomycin and ceftiofur, together on the same plasmid. But you may have beside that lots of bacteria which have only spectinomycin resistance. Then you throw spectinomycin on them. Who tells you that those which have the CMY are going to overgrow those which have only the spectinomycin resistance? Okay, so there is a lot of work to be done in vivo to see exactly what's going on, what these plasmids have, what they encode, if some of them encode colonization factors and other not, and so on. There is a tons of work to be done to validate these molecular data to show if they have any significance practically or not. Okay, and that's probably our next step in terms of research. Good. To finish, I'd like to thank our collaborators. I hope I've not forgotten too many. There are, of course, all the CPARS people we've collaborated with over the years. There is the people from MAPAC, Marina Do in particular, the people from my lab who have worked on the results I showed in the presentation. Georgia Slavish from AHL, we've been collaborating a lot with her on these kind of issues. And for stats, we've relied a lot on David Pearl, and I'd like to thank him too. Funding from different sources. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Patrick. I'm sure that you would be more than happy to entertain a few questions. I think we have 6-7 minutes. Not a whole lot of time for questions, but the floor is open. Lydia?
I'm not actually just like yes. Or are they co-evolving different ways to come up with a horn in a horn in a rhinoceros?
So it's about the geography.
You can repeat your question. Oh,
yeah. It's about the evolution of these resistances in terms of geography and parallel evolution, or do they move around and you have a single evolution path and then the bugs are going to distribute all over the planet? I think both are happening. The the CTXM1 gene that I showed you, which is emerging in Canada, is present in Europe since quite a few years. It's a major resistance gene to ceftiofur in animals in Europe, for instance. And it's been there since 10, 15 years, okay? I was just reading a paper today morning where they were citing numbers like 20% of animals carry a CTXM1 positive bacterium in the gut, okay? Here in Canada, it's much less, okay? But in Canada, it's emerging here, but in Canada, we have this CMY2 gene, or in North America, we have this CMY2 gene, which is present since probably 20 years. Now, the first description was in cattle, and it was in the 80s, okay? So 20, 30 years. And it's now going to Europe, and they see it emerging in Europe. So your geographical transfer of things, parallel evolution, of maybe different genes, but encoding for the same almost the same resistances at different places is occurring. So you have that parallel evolution, definitely, yes.
Thank you.
you. It's a very good presentation. We were talking about how E. coli is changing your own genes and then microbial resistance genes. And did you think about to study Salmonella and E. coli from the same sample and to see how they are transmitting? Because
no. No, we've not looked, the presence of E. coli and Salmonella, the resistance in E. coli and Salmonella in the same animal. Do they transfer, happen within the same animal? We've not done it with that kind of study. Case Poppy, who was a researcher at the Public Health Agency, the LFZ, a few years ago, has done some transfer experiment in vivo, where he showed that the CMY gene, for instance, can be transferred in vivo between E. coli and Salmonella and between different E. coli. So that transfer in vivo has been proven, definitely, yes.
Perhaps I can ask a question. And I see John kind of moving around, so probably to ask maybe the last question. So Patrick, as you know, there are a lot of movements around, you know, alternatives to antimicrobials, mm-hmm. and there is a huge list of things, you know, that people have used or will use in the near future as alternatives to antimicrobials. Do you anticipate that we're going to develop some sort of resistance to those antimicrobials, and then perhaps there's some sort of a co-selection scenarios that one can envisage?
I have no clue, sincerely. I don't know if there will be a co-selection to alternatives at the same time as to antibiotics. I would expect that a lot of alternatives, there will be resistances, I may say it that way, which will develop. Because again, when we are developing this aggression or this alternative to antibiotics, we are trying to displace the bacteria.
That's right.
And what bacteria tend to do, not on purpose, what they tend to do is to colonize environment to survive and multiply. So we try to displace them. I won't be surprised that they will develop strategies over time to recolonize this environment. So I would expect some resistances to occur. Again, it depends a lot on what kind of alternative, what kind of strategies. Some are more prone and easier to develop resistance to than others. Phages, for instance, I would expect, despite what phage specialists say, I would expect resistance to occur pretty fast. Probiotics may be a bit more complex, I would suspect. Again, it depends a lot on the strategy.
John?
On the NAFTA, which I think may be renegotiated, I think 10% of newly hatched chickens have to come from the US.
Yep.
And so people sometimes will point fingers there about what's coming in and the quality of those chickens. But that leads me to your second question. What's going on in the hatcheries? Surely this is a hygiene problem. Why are we injecting eggs with antibiotics to stop naval infections? You know, surely there's a huge place to look really carefully at the quality of hatchery hygiene. And nobody seems to be doing that. They just kind of throw up their hands and say, well, it's US chickens.
And I, in terms of what happens at the hatchery level, in terms of the prevention of the disease by hygiene, and prevention rather than by use of antibiotics. Sincerely, I don't know. I'm not aware of many studies going on at that level. And I absolutely agree with you, it's a critical point to look at. My take on the use of many antibiotics is they are frequently a replacement for not so good management. Okay, we've seen what happens in Europe. It can be compensated by better management at the price. Usually, but it can be compensated by better management. And among others, probably at the hatchery, as you say. It's a critical intervention point, I think. I think Chaba was fixing.
I want to answer, because in Ontario, they are not injecting antibiotics anymore into rats. Maybe in the US, I do not inject. They stopped in 1.5 years.
Yeah.
According to poultry farmers here, what we get from the U.S. is the garbage, what's left over when they sell it.
Yep, heard that before, too. But I still want to travel to the U.S. once in a while, so I'm not going to express it.
Well, thank you very much, Patrick. It's been wonderful. And as a token of appreciation on behalf of the Quality Health Research Network.
Thanks a lot.
Well, please join me and to thank Dr. Boerlin for his wonderful presentation. you're going to be having a seminar given by Dr. Mike Joyce on March the 7th, am I correct, Eddie? And our research date is almost finalized and confirmed for April the 24th. And the format is going to be a combination format, meaning that we're going to have a few presentations and so forth by students and postdocs, and then that's going to be followed by a roundtable discussion around antimicrobial stewardship in poultry. So the sort of things that Dr. Preston was referring to, the better management systems and so on, these are going to be also discussed at that time on April the 24th at our room. Okay, thank you.